Penguin Random House Audio presents Social Creature by Tara Isabella Burton. Read for you by Saskia Maarleveld. Chapter 1. The first party Lavinia takes Louise to, she makes Louise wear one of her dresses.
"I found it on the street," Lavinia says. "It's from the 20s.
"Maybe it is.
Someone just left it there. Can you believe it?"
Louise can't.
"They probably just thought it was trash."
She puckers her lips. She puts on lipstick.
"And that is the problem with people. Nobody understands what things mean."
Lavinia fiddles with Louise's collar. Lavinia ties the sash around Louise's waist.
"Anyway, the second I saw it, Christ, I wanted to... Oh, I just wanted to genuflect, you know? Kiss the ground.
Do Catholics kiss the ground, or is that just sailors?
Anyway, I wanted to put my mouth right there on the sidewalk on someone's chewed gum and say, like, thank you, God, for making the world make sense today."
Lavinia puts powder on Louise's cheeks. Lavinia adds rouge. Lavinia keeps talking.
"Like, it's all so fucking perfect, right? Like, somebody's grandmother or whoever dies in some random brownstone in the East Village nobody's even visited in 20 years, and they dump all her shit out into the street. And then at sunset, here I am walking across East 9th Street and I find it. This old woman and I, who have never met, have these two beautiful, poetic nights 90 years apart, wearing the exact same dress. Oh, Louise, can't you just smell it?"
Lavinia shoves the lace in Louise's face.
"You could fall in love," says Lavinia. "Wearing a dress like that?"
Louise inhales. "So you know what I did?" Lavinia gives Louise a beauty mark with her eyebrow pencil.
"I stripped down to my underwear. No, that's a lie. I took my bra off, too. I took off everything and I put on the dress and left my other one in the street and I walked all night wearing it. All the way back to the Upper East Side."
Lavinia does Louise's buttons.
Now Lavinia is laughing. "Stick with me long enough," she says, "and I promise, things will just happen to you, like they happened to me."
Lavinia does Louise's hair.
At first she tries to do it, like she's done her own, savagely and exuberantly tendrilled. But Louise's hair is too flat and too straight. And so instead, Lavinia braids it into a tight, neat bun. Lavinia puts her hands on Louise's cheeks. She kisses her on the forehead. She roars. "God," says Lavinia. "You look so beautiful. I can't stand it. Oh, I want to kill you. Let's take a picture."
She takes out her phone. She makes it a mirror.
"Let's stand against the peacock feathers," Lavinia says.
Louise does.
"Pose!"
Louise doesn't know how.
"Oh, please."
Lavinia waves the phone.
"Everybody knows how to pose. Just, you know, arch your back a little, tilt your head, pretend you're a silent film star. There! There, no, chin down. There."
Lavinia moves Louise's chin. She takes their photo.
"The last one's good," Lavinia says. "We look good. I'm posting it."
She turns the phone to Louise.
"Which filter do you like?"
Louise doesn't recognize herself. Her hair is sleek, her lips are dark, her cheekbones are high. She's wearing a flapper dress and she has cat's eyes and fake lashes. And she looks like she's not even from this century. She looks like she's not even real.
"Let's go with Mayfair. It makes your cheekbones look shiny. Christ, look at you. Look at you. You're beautiful."
Lavinia has captioned the photo, "A like in indignity." Louise thinks this is very witty. Louise thinks, "I am not myself." "Thank God," Louise thinks. "Thank God." They cab it to Chelsea. Lavinia pays. It's New Year's Eve. Louise has known Lavinia for 10 days. They have been the best 10 days of her life.
Days don't go like this for Louise. Louise's days go like this. She wakes up. She wishes she hasn't. Chances are, Louise hasn't slept much. She works as a barista at this coffee shop that turns into a wine bar at night, and also writes for this e-commerce site called glitz that sells knockoff handbags, and is also an SAT tutor. She sets an alarm for at least 3 hours before she has to be anywhere, because she lives deep in Sunset Park, a 20-minute walk from the R, in the same illegal and roach-infested sublet she's been in for almost 8 years. And half the time, the train breaks down. When they call her, once every couple of months, Louise's parents invariably ask her why she's so stubborn about moving back to New Hampshire, say where that nice Virgil Bryce is a manager at the local bookstore now, and he won't stop asking for her new number. Louise invariably hangs up. She weighs herself. Louise weighs 114.5 pounds on a period day. She puts on her makeup very carefully. She draws on her brows. She checks her roots. She checks her bank balance. $64.33. She covers up the flaws in her skin. She looks in the mirror. Today, she says out loud. A therapist she once had told her that it's always better to say these things out loud. Is the first day of the rest of your life. She makes herself smile. Her therapist told her to do that, too. Louise walks the 20 minutes to the subway. She ignores the catcaller who asks her every morning how her pussy smells, even though he's probably the only person in the world she interacts with regularly. She spends the ride into Manhattan staring at her reflection in the darkened subway windows. Back when Louise was sure she was going to be a go-down-in-history great writer, she used to take a notebook and use the commute to write stories. But now she is too tired, and also she probably will never be a writer. So she reads trashy misandry articles on her phone, and sometimes watches people. Louise enjoys watching people. She finds it calming. When you spend a lot of time focusing on the things wrong with other people, you worry less about everything wrong with you. Louise goes to work as a barista, or at glitz, or to give an SAT lesson. She likes lessons best. When she speaks with her very carefully cultivated mid-Atlantic accent and puts her very carefully dyed blonde hair into a bun and alludes to the fact that she went to school in Devonshire, New Hampshire, she gets $80 an hour, plus the satisfaction of having fooled somebody. Now, if Louise had actually gone to Devonshire Academy, the boarding prep school, and not just the public Devonshire High, she'd get $250. But the kind of parents who can pay $250 are more assiduous in checking these things. Not that most people ever check these things. When Louise was 16, she took to leaving her house early and eating breakfast and dinner at the Academy's dining hall. She made it a whole 3 months watching people before anybody noticed. And even then, it was just her mother who found out and grounded her. And by the time she was allowed out of the house again, she'd started aim-chatting Virgil Bryce, who didn't like it when she went anywhere without him. Louise finishes work. She looks in her phone mirror a few times to make sure she's still there. She checks Tinder, even though she hardly responds to anybody she matches with. There was one guy who seemed really feminist online, but turned out to practice relationship anarchy, and another who was really into kink in ways that she was never entirely sure were not abusive, and one guy who was really great, actually, but he ghosted her after 2 months. Sometimes Louise considers going out with somebody new, but this seems like just another thing to potentially fuck up. Sometimes, if Louise has been paid cash that week, she goes to a really nice bar on Clinton or Rivington or on the Upper East Side. She orders the nicest drink she can afford. Louise can't really afford to be drinking at all, but even Louise deserves nice things, sometimes. She sips her drink very, very slowly. If she doesn't eat dinner, Louise never eats dinner, the alcohol will hit her harder, which is a relief, because when Louise gets drunk, she forgets the invariable fact that she is going to fuck everything up one day, if she hasn't already. Whether it's because she loses all her jobs at once and gets evicted, or because she gains 20 pounds because she is too tired to exercise.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.